Judith made for the southern tip of the Snowdonia National Park and the seaside town of Barmouth.
From a distance, Barmouth looks as if it's stopped for a picnic, strung along the wide sand brim of the Maldarg estuary, at the foot of the hills which rise to the mountains of Snowdonia. It's picked the perfect spot. Yet 200 years ago, Barmouth was already a holiday resort. The sea to its front, the river by its side, and the hills behind were all it needed to attract the stagecoach parties of early tourists. Not much has changed. Barmouth has little apart from its position to offer its visitors today. But for most of them, that's enough. Their families mainly, happy with the sand and the scenery, some walking, some touring, and the basics of Barmouth itself. The main entertainment is the fun fair, now that the cinemas have gone, although by this summer it's hoped there will be a cabaret bar. There are fishing trips from the harbour, a ferry across the estuary, and donkeys on the long, safe sand beach. For all these small hotels and guest houses along the seafront, twice as many holidaymakers stay in caravans as in the town. A new six-berth caravan like this costs from £37 to £100 a week, including gas and VAT. This site is a quiet one with its own shop and laundry. For years, Barmouth has been known as the Gibraltar of Wales because of the way the hillside rises sheer behind the high street.
Barmouth's oldest houses are here, built up the cliff face one on top of another, and many of them in fact can only be reached by these steep flights of steps. Now if you carry on above the houses, you come to a network of footpaths in the town's other dimension, a series of hill walks within minutes of the beach.
One, the panorama walk, has superb views over the estuary towards the peak of Cader Idris. To the north of Barmouth are other valleys and other views. But these are landscapes which demand more than just looking. The Welsh will tell you they started pony trekking, and be that as it may, they've certainly turned it into a significant industry. At this centre, where farm buildings have been converted into self-catering cottages and flats, a unit sleeping up to six costs from £60 to £70 a week. Riding is £3 an hour extra. Well, sightseeing from horseback may be popular, but 9 out of 10 visitors come by car and use Barmouth as a base. 10 miles to the north is Harlech, whose men manned the ramparts in the Wars of the Roses, when the castle was already nearly 200 years old. Up the road, Port Maddock and the Festiniog Narrow Gauge Railway. It's one of the 7 great little trains of Wales. With names like Blanche and Linda, Festiniog's 6 steam engines are the Shetland ponies of the railway world, with legs not quite as big as their hearts. They come bustling round the mountain when they come, climbing high on the side of the valley towards the slate mining town of Blaenau Ffestiniog.
Wales' great little trains all run on narrow gauge track. After that, the similarities end. Each has its own distinct character. Here, they simply set out to provide a scenic day under steam.
150 years ago, the line carried slate, and just a few miles from the railhead on a hillside strewn with the glistening slivers of slate waste, you can join a different kind of train and disappear down the tunnels of a disused mine, the caverns of Hecuth. Deep inside the mountain, the guide, himself an ex-miner, recalls the days when no one came here for a holiday.
Again, is there too wide? And up to 1946, that is before the introduction of the pit lamp here, all these mines were worked by candlelight.
Hecuth and other mines like it are preserving the industrial archaeology of Wales. This operatic little village is, believe it or not, just as Welsh and, if anything, more strictly preserved for its architecture. Port Merion sprang from the imagination of one man, the late Sir Clough Williams Ellis, although bits of its scaled-down buildings came from wherever that imagination could lay hold of them. The clock on the campanile is from a brewery. The Buddha was given by Ingrid Bergman. This whole facade was a fireplace.
From its beginnings in the 20s, Port Merion has always been a hotel, at one time a very exclusive one too. Noel Coward wrote Blythe's Spirit here, and the story goes that George Bernard Shaw was actually turned away three times.
The original hotel on the quayside sleeps about 30, but almost every building in the village provides either additional hotel rooms or self-catering cottages.
The best summing up of Port Merion came from the man who built it. He called it a people sanctuary, which is just what a holiday spot should be.